So like in a quarterback, now in high school, you can play with it. A lot of times you may have two kids that you friends inside of you. And when you were looking for a quarterback in the National Football League or recruiting in college, there's a profile that you kind of look for. And one of the things, sitting down with personnel people in the NFL years ago, in St. Louis, the thing that astonished me were all the criteria that they would list that they need to look for in a quarterback. And they gave that different weights or importance numbers, arm strength, all these other things. Why wouldn't you do the very best for these MPs? Does anybody know who Ernie's MPs is, right? All that stuff. Okay. Well, Ernie's MPs, if I asked him, I was at Arizona State, I was a coordinator there for a long time, I was there for 9 years, and went over to the Rams. I said, Ernie, what do you look for in a quarterback? He said, Mike, it's very simple. There's only Ernie can say, if the kid can't throw it in a straight line from point A to point B, chances are he's not going to be a good quarterback. But it isn't. So accuracy, above all else, is the most important thing for a passer. Now, I do understand, too, the concept of what's happening today. That quarterback position, the read option of that, in the old, years ago, when you had a prototype offense, the quarterback wasn't really involved unless he was throwing football. Well, by doing what guys are doing today, he's involved in every play because he can run the read option, he can run the ball. And so I get that. That's easier. I understand all that. But what I'm talking about today is actually just developing the passing skills of the young men. First criteria is the accuracy. Didn't say anything about arm strength, didn't say anything about spin on the ball, didn't say anything about how big he is, any of that stuff. It's accuracy. And as you look at the second thing, is toughness. Now we're talking about mental and physical toughness. Now the physical toughness part of it, obviously he's got to be resilient, be able to bounce back and get knocked around, because he will get knocked around. Right? But more importantly, the emotional toughness of it. Because guys, really, the most competitive guy on the field, other than yourself, has ever been a quarterback. Of all the players that you have, so when you go to select that guy, he may be the prettiest guy, 6'4", throw a nice ball, but if he's not emotionally a tough dude, because when things are bad, as you know, standing on the sideline, those players look at other people. They look at you as a coach, and they look at that quarterback, and they want to see how you respond. You look for that personality as well. And then the third thing is the intelligence. I'm not talking about how smart he is intellectually. I'm talking about a guy who can react to what he sees and make a quick decision. It's that type of intelligence that's important. Okay? So in other words, it's that basically tied in with his skill set, where he can look at something and make a quick decision without having to go through that whole process of what he should do. So he can react. And then he can assimilate information quickly and easily without having to have a lot of repetition. Those are the three things that we measure. Nowhere does it say he's got to be 6'4". Nowhere does it say he's got to have all these other things that, if you look at an NFL sheet that evaluates the quarterback, it's all a bunch of garbage accounts. Because if you don't have those three things, you might be good occasionally. You might be a little bit of a streaky guy. But if you're not high marks in all three of those areas, then you won't be consistent with the players. And guys, they come in all shapes and sizes. Just look at the league. Whether it's a guy up there in Seattle, Wilson, down in New Orleans, to 6'5", all the big gun from arm, the guy, Kurt Warner, this is true story, Kurt Warner. I put a $50 bill, I tied it to the wall. I said, Kurt. And so all of a sudden, I said, when we can verify that you've thrown a spot for like $50 a year, we had Kurt for 4 years, that money was still on the wall. And he left. That's a true story. And Ricky Prohl, Ozzie Keene, and Marshall Falk, they pushed, run that back. I think I saw that ball spin pretty good. They go back and we evaluate. The point being, that ball can go end over end. So it's as accurate as either on time. Good decisions, who cares? He's 5'10", who cares? What difference does it make? If he's the best competitor, can throw the ball well, tough. Now, preparation, I'm skipping through this stuff now very fast, but I want to hit these points. In preparation, it amazes me, I did the NFL PA bowl game out in LA last week, and I was shocked and stunned at how much football those players don't know. Because of the whole thing today, and it's not an option, it's just different. It's to run as many plays as fast as you can, copy. They don't know anything about football. But what we've always done, no matter what level I was at, when I started high school, college, or international football game, if a quarterback does not know what he's looking at, how can he make a good decision? So for 1 week in the NFL, when we put a new system in, the quarterbacks would come in for 8 hours a day, and we teach them defense. Now, because you can see cover three, and that cover three, everybody plays cover three with their own little touch to it. The corners are shuffle, back pedal, their spot droppers inside, their match, they're playing match, they're playing the quarterback with their eyes. There's all different kinds of nuances, and they're trying to look for that in the philosophy. Because when you start to teach the offense and make decisions, if they don't understand what the defense is trying to do, the alignments, and the whole philosophy of what's in front of them, how do they make a good decision? Then they just become a robot. Because things will break down, and if they really truly understand what they're seeing, whether it's cover two, whether it's an underground cover one, man coverage, whatever it is, if things kind of fall apart, they'll make good decisions. You can trust them. And there's a whole hour to all that. But just make sure that what information you have as an offensive coach, you've imparted them about defense. They understand defensive structures. So that when you try to teach them to play, and you go through the process of what you want them to do, they'll understand it as it applies to that defense. If they don't know why they're doing it, they don't know why, chances are they won't do it consistently well. And that's the premise of that, okay? All right, then the film study and practice habits. I was shocked. I didn't realize this. You just assume, I guess, two main things as a coach, but we actually sat down with young quarterbacks in the National Football League and taught them how to look at film, what to look at. Because we all do this. I mean, you start looking at game tape as a coach to break it down, and the first time you look at an opponent halfway through the game, what are you doing? You're watching the game like you're a fan of the game. You're watching the game, aren't you? I do it all the time. I start watching the whole thing. There has to be a process. Write down a piece of paper. I had a little list of things. I didn't bring it because I know you have to do it. A list of things that you want him to look at and understand when he looks at the game. The corners, the depth of the corners, how many times they pressure, what kinds of pressure, have them draw pressure. Help them learn and honor the game of football. Honor the game of football. Teach them the right way. Okay? All right. I'm going to jump ahead here a little bit and talk to you about decision making and the odds before I do the actual fundamentals. Because if I don't, I won't get to it, and it's really incredibly important. Okay. So, let's talk about the eyes first. It's amazing to me, too, that we talk about taking the ball from the center, drop back, within the gunner, underneath the center, doesn't make all those things that apply to the quarterback. But how many of you guys talk to the quarterback about how he's looking at it? Whether it's a ball exchange, it's a handoff, it makes a difference. What he does with his eyes is incredibly important. So when he's either the shotgun or underneath the center, what do you want to look at? What do you want to see? Right, so if it's a pass play, and I'm trying to keep coverage, for me, I'm going to have a look at the two safeties, and on the snap, he'll get a feel of what the coverage is. And there's clues that we get, so he's always looking at something. If it's a run, we have to look at the safeties. And come back and practice, what was the front? What was the coverage? What was the run? I want to know exactly what happened on defense. So he's in that game, and he understands every snap. He should know what's going on. He's seen everything. So that if they run some sort of zone dog early in the game and it's a run, he's already seen that. He didn't just skip through it because he's handing the ball. Keep them engaged the entire time. Right? That's first of all. So as he gets back on a pass play, as he's coming away from the center, we'll go through the footwork in a second. What do you want him to see? We identify the coverage. And then you want to hold his eyes in the middle as long as you can until two steps from, or two count, basically, from the time you release the ball, makes that decision. For us, it's two steps or what we call two quick hitches. We'll get that in a second. So as he comes away from the center and watch this now, because I can't tell you hundreds of times when I'm evaluating quarterbacks in college coming out where their head is like this. They're back and forth, they're looking all over the place. And you stand behind a quarterback in practice and watch his helmet fall over. Just think about this. What's he seeing? He's trying to see everything. It's like being on a car going down a railroad track and saying, hey, listen, what's in front of you? And you're looking like this the whole time. It's too much information. You can't see it all. You're trying to see too much. Be specific about what you want him to see and identify. And the stuff that isn't important is extra energy. You don't have to worry about that. Calm him down. I can't prove this to you because I haven't done this study, but the more active he is with his head, the more confused he gets. There's too much information coming in. Look at too many things. We had a young man in this bowl game out there. I won't tell you his name or where he was from, but he's a nice little prospect. And we came back after a pass playing team, and he just did not do very well with the play. He ended up running the ball because he didn't want to throw it. But I watched his helmet coming away, and it's kind of a tough habit to break, and I said, well, what were you looking at? I know what we told him to look at, but when, you know, I looked to the left and I saw him, but then I looked at him and he couldn't tell me. They should tell you exactly the information that you want them to know and come back to you. Calm them down. When they move their head around so fast, they start to play the game and they get very, very tense. Calm their head down. And that goes back into the football too. Decision making. And this is at the very heart of the soul. I want to get to this right now. Or go to stuff like that, because I won't get to it if you get hung up. So, decision making. There's a couple things that are just in granite and it's golden. Never make a decision on where to throw the football. You're looking at the defender. If I'm going to throw a simple curl flat combination, I am not going to come back and keep or look at the flat defender to decide where to throw. Then they know why. I mean, know why. It makes a lot of sense when you think about it. Because when you do that, you have to look at it and think about that movement and then make a decision of which guy you're going to throw the ball. And the chance that now you're late on the throw to be doing. Right away, you're late. And then as you look at him and you look to throw, his movement changes. He gets straightened up and all of a sudden he's falling back into it. He can bait you. So in a zone, you have a designated receiver that you want that quarterback to throw. Start with the floor. This is our number one guy, first and foremost. And that read progressions you hear talk about all these guys, these color announcers on the NFL when you watch a game, they're so full of baloney, it just makes me sick sometimes. Well, you know, he was a third or fourth guy in the progression. You know how stupid that is? There's no such animal as good guys. There just isn't. It's 1-2, and if that ball's not out of there, he's just looking for something to get to, or he's on the run. It's 1-2, or done. And sometimes we always have a check down over the ball, no matter what the protection, so that he can just get to it. Might be the tight end, might be the fullback, might be a halfback, might be a receiver, but we've got a guy there in that area, so I can get there real quick, get a pass, if he's getting pulled down or whatever the case may be in the pocket. So it's always 1-2 versus zone. That's really important. So how do you agree? You come back, and once you approach the back of your drop, you put your eyes right where you want to throw the football, where you anticipate throwing the football. And then if there's a hole there, you let it go. That's anticipating the throw. That goes back to that football intelligence I was talking about earlier that you're going to evaluate. Number two. When you warm up and you throw routes on air to your receiver, to groove, the timing, and all that sort of thing, watch the quarterback. He can never track a receiver. When it's man-to-man, it's a lot of fun because there's nobody underneath it, so you can just watch him run. And you know what happens when you track a receiver? First of all, you're going to miss him. How many guys up front here shoot birds and stuff like that? Yeah, shoot in front. Don't you have to shoot up in front of him? Yeah. So you create a drill. And it's real simple. And you're going to run, for instance, a 10-yard post pattern. If you stand out there and you think the ball should be caught, then you have to look at, take the drop and throw the ball at you and fielders him come into it. Quick story, when I was at Mason College in 76 and 77, I know I don't look at it, but in 76 and 77, we had a young man named Steve Fairchild. He was 5'11", 6-foot-ish, 175 pounds from Patrick Henry High School, threw the ball about 45 yards at the best. The 2 years that he was with us, we played all night games, San Diego Mason Junior College. Well, he broke every passing record there was in junior college football. He was a national MVP for 2 years in a row. Never been done before, hasn't been done since. Just put on, And that concept that we just talked about, you go into a spot, if there's color there, they get out. You don't have to recognize who it is. For Dennis is a man. It was a safety or linebacker, it was a bad guy, right? There's a bad guy, they don't throw it. Get to your check down. Find it. You know where you're supposed to be, right? And you work those drills. Well, Steve, after all these great numbers and everything, of course, you know, at that point, at that age, I thought it was all coaching. So he said, hey, coach, after the last game, he said, I got to talk to you. I got to tell you something. I was kind of nervous. I said, oh, man, you talk to me. I thought he was going to tell me to like me. He hated his time there. The look on his face was kind of nervous. I was kind of nervous. He said, you know, I have night blindness. I said, yeah, right. He said, no, I have to do. I've got night blindness. I was diagnosed with night blindness my senior year in high school. I said, that makes no sense. We play our games at nine. He throws for 4 yards a quarterback and just really gave it this low. I said, no. He said, you know, so what we were doing just kind of made sense because he said, I can't focus on anything further than 20 yards down the field. Everything's just a color smudge at night. I can't focus on it. I said, so. He said, yeah, well, you know, that depth perception I can feel. I can't tell if it's a linebacker or safety. I can't tell any of that stuff. I can see movement, depth perception. It's like going home, or just no call. Really? So you listen to the guys on TV. I've coached that way all my life and never changed that. Why would you make the game any more complicated than that? Why? It doesn't have to be. It sounds smart, but we've got the progression over here. We got the that's a bunch of work. Keep it simple. You know where you're supposed to throw the ball through it. Oh, there's somebody there. I'm going to check it down there. Oh, he's covered too. I'm running for my life. I'm trying to check down over the ball. That's it. No matter what concept you're dealing with, don't make it any more difficult than that. We had a young man at the Chicago Bears, who probably remember an NFC Championship game. He certainly. He was our third quarterback. He was certainly good enough to play the league and start and be a real good player, but he had one major flaw. Remember that intelligence I was talking about? He's a brilliant guy out of Colorado State. He's really a smart guy. But from that position wise, I'd ask him, now, why'd you sort of follow this play? Well, I felt like, you know, that it would tell you to insert that. Those guys went from the ball. Well, you know, maybe I thought that I saw the safety. Did we ask you to do that? We just throw the ball back. Put the ball out there. Trust what we're telling you to do. And that's the only way to get to let go of that ball. In practice, I've always said with quarterbacks, I don't care how many interceptions you throw in practice, I really don't. As long as they start getting crazy, at the time, obviously. That's the only way to learn. They've got to be able to trust that the receiver's going to be there on time. And we have the same for receivers. Be where you're supposed to be, when you're supposed to be there, and don't pull the quarterback. So if you're supposed to be 14, you're 14. Otherwise, you can't develop that continuity within your passing game. It's very, very important. Okay? Right. Within that pass play, initially, your first read sometimes can change based on coverage. And that's why when you come away, you've got to see the coverage. But also, on every pass play that you have, and I don't know how many of you guys see press a man, maybe you do, maybe you don't. But if you do, you have to have a man receiver that if you know it's man to man, the best route is this route right here, and that's what you throw. And even though the reader and zone's over here, you get mad at this guy on this route, maybe it's a hit. But we know this is just a game, you just come up and throw. It's your completions. This route over here is a curl flat, I don't really like because the guy's sitting on it, or the slant, or whatever it is that you want to put in for him. And maybe your first read is your man receiver, I don't know. But when you build it in there, that's a good way to go. Okay? All right. Okay, so let's get to the nitty-gritty. All right. So I know that a lot of you, if not all of you, are in shotgun. being underneath the center. And I do know over the years, that's kind of dissipated or gone away, and but it does apply to footwork anyway, especially to being in the gut. They're all correlated, so we'll tie it together in a second. All right, so when I'm underneath the center, and I'm taking the exchange, take the forefinger right there of the right hand, and goes right down the crack of the center's rear end, just like that. Now you see my hand is off at an angle like that. You see that? So this ball does not come up sideways. Does not come up sideways. It comes up at an angle to fit that hand and to fit this crotch. It should come up like this, just like that. Right? It fits right in the hand, just like that. Right? So you take the other part, the little bees, and just set them in there like that. So your hands will be a little bit tweaked underneath there. But remember, that ball should come up and turn just like this and rotate the ball so that the core back will hit the laces as the ball hits his hand. Right. So we're underneath the center. He's going to give him a little bit of pressure so he knows where the target is. Stance underneath the center. If I have a parallel stance underneath the center, it's extremely inefficient. To get away from there, I have to step forward to go back. It's like your feet are nailed to the ground. Or I've really got to do something, step sideways to get that foot to go. So we're in a bicycle, we'll call bicycle stance. You ever sat on a bicycle and stood up on it? The same thing, right foot forward, left foot back. Right foot forward, left foot back. Would you stand up for a second? Okay, so if you were flat-footed there, and I push you, you kind of shuffle back, but not get into a bicycle stance. Left foot back, tighter together, a little closer together. Now the natural deal is if I push you and see how your right foot came off the ground, you naturally want to pick that right foot and step with it. And that's what it's supposed to be. So if I'm going to drop back underneath the center, or handle, whatever, this is my natural stance, like this. And I don't want my feet wide. I just watched the bowl game here. The quarterback's underneath the center, and I think they're on the 2-yard line or three, whatever, but they had a guard who was going to pull, and he stepped on the quarterback's foot and he fell back to the end zone. I don't know if you guys saw that or not. That's heresy. Okay, just that. Well, what happens is you want to get in that good breakdown stance. But underneath the center, that's the last thing you want. You want your feet tight like this so that you can move quickly out of there. That way. Not that way or that way or that way. That way. Efficiently. Okay? Now, can I go open to the left and get the, absolutely. I just got to push off that front foot and go to the left. But most of the time, I'm dropping back and I'm dropping back this way. And I can come out and handball off like that as well, right? Bicycle stance will reduce them. Now, as far as they want to keep their feet apart, you don't have to reduce it. They're much better in a reduced stance. The first thing that happens when their bicycle stance and their feet are wide is when they step, this foot comes clear around past that foot. All right, so come away from the center. You want to make sure that foot is going right back at 6 o'clock, 4 o'clock being the center's ass. Okay. So as I come on here, I want that foot to come right back behind this foot right here. Most guys, when you start doing it, time after time, will step all the way around the foot like this. So it changes their line of force. You guys that know physics, it's a line of force in inertia. So as I get away, if I pivot it like this, a couple things happen. I've lost all the inertia that I started. I've pivoted and left my upper body over that front foot or over that pivot step. So when you come away, you're stepping, you want to throw your shoulders onto that foot right there. Step away, pull that foot right back here, just like that. Now, so many times, and I go to a lot of high school games, I've got grandkids and my brother's grandkids that we can watch play. I love them. It's a thrill for me, but sometimes you see the quarterbacks up underneath the center like this. You know what I mean? They're so tight and snug, and sometimes it's because they're smaller guys. It doesn't need to be that way. You want to separate and get away. You want to reach. The numbers should be straight up and down. I don't care how tall, whether it's 6'5 or not. And flex with those knees and get comfortable. And reach underneath there and take the ball like this. Don't hug him. You can't get away. It's not comfortable for him and not for you. You can't move. You don't have the freedom to move with it. Okay? And it's all about balance anyway. All right? Okay. Now we'll start talking about getting away. Right. First of all, as you have your hand on the ball, The ball should never sit in the palm here. It never sat in the palm. You have pressure points, the thumb and the fingers. The ball, when the ball is released up here, you see how my knuckles go at an angle to the laces? Your knuckles should never, ever be parallel to the laces. If you have a guy that can't spin the ball, chances are he has what we call a fat hand, meaning that ball is resting and his hand is rotated down underneath the ball like this. And there's a lot of guys that can kind of throw the ball pretty good that have that fat hand. But it's all arm and they don't spin the ball very well. And the spin of the ball improves your accuracy. That's why it's important. Okay? Whether or not your forefinger's up towards the tip or not, doesn't make any difference. It's whatever, your hand size has a lot to do with it. I have a very small hand, and what this is very true, by the way. So I have my finger is up towards, away from the tip of the ball, only more towards the laces here. Guys with large hands, that finger might be towards the point. That doesn't matter. The last thing that comes off the ball is a forefinger on the side right there. You guys have thrown the ball a lot, you have a blister on the side of your finger there, doing it right. That's the thing that spins the ball. Remember, throwing the ball is a series of levers that starts with your feet. It goes from your feet, your knees, your hips, your shoulders, your elbow, your wrist, all the way through, just like that. When you interrupt the lever system, you have to put more effort and compensate someplace else. See, so many guys, good quarterbacks in the league, that don't use their legs very well, and they compensate because they got such great arms and wrists, and they can get away with it. But when it's all working, the ball comes off your hand and says, and when they first feel that, when they're pulling all the levers, they'll look at you and say, whoa, I hardly threw that, the ball just took off. Because you're efficient. It goes back to the physics system. And we'll get to that when we start into the throwing again. Okay? All right, so we're getting away from the center now. We know how we want the ball. As we come away on any ball exchange, we're going to buckle the ball. Buckle the ball means it's just above, right where my belly button is. And we'll come back and just like the clock we talked about, there's 12, there's 6, 5, 4, etc., etc. So you have to tell him on ball exchange, come away from the center, the angle that you want. If I'm on an inside zone, hand the ball up deep, I want to come back at 5 o'clock, not 4, because I don't want to cut his chance to come back on. Okay? Alright, so as you come back, there's a point where you want him to have the ball by 5 yards, right? So you come back, and on the exchange, guys, tell them to settle themselves a bit. Not stop, settle. So as they come back, they set, they buckle the ball, and they punch and look at the target right in the gut, right here, and shirt, and then finish. On every handoff, don't let them be sloppy. Make them finish on a pass set or a move play. We used to tell the quarterbacks all the time, on some of them, but like the power plays, we would boot them and tell them, you look at the end, I don't have time to do that. When that end is not paying attention to you anymore, the linebacker, then we'll run some move plays. Good information over reverse, etc. Keep them involved with that. It's very, very important. Defense has still got to pay attention to them. Don't let them take their eyes off it, okay? All right. Once you're in the shotgun now, the shotgun stance is the same stance. Not wide. The difference here now is you have your thumbs up like a shortstop. So I can feel that ball if it's errant in any way. And we all know those snaps are going to be errant a lot of times, right? Left, right. The worst ones are the high ones. You can handle a skipper or one that's low on the knees. The ones that are difficult are the ones that are up in here. You have to change your hands radically. All right, so once you get the ball on a handoff out of the gun, the same thing applies. You flip your hip to your belly button and you settle yourself and make sure that you see the ball going to his belly and finish however you want to finish. Very, very important. Okay. There are a couple things underneath the center that are really important for those of you that want to do it. Number one, the draw. If I'm going to come away with a draw from the center, I'm going to hand the ball off at 5 yards. But here's the deal. Most guys, when I was growing up in football, they said, if you want to hold that ball real high, and the first thing you tell a linebacker, anytime a quarterback comes away from the center and holds the ball real high, it's a draw. It's an obvious key for a linebacker, so why would you do that, right? So you come back just like you hold it in your chest just where you would normally when you drop, and then snap to and settle on the exchange. Don't run through the exchanges. That's an easy thing for them. They want to hurry back to the center and run through it. They lay the ball on the hip all the time. settle, and then finish. As you come away from center on a draw, your eyes are on the linebackers for a step, and then start turning to, and on the third step, your settlement on the exchange with the running back. Okay? 1, 2, 3, exchange, settle, and then finish fast. The hardest quarterback center exchange there is pitch and fall against a shaded dome. So I'm underneath the center. There's a shade to that side, and I'm going to reverse out and pitch the ball a little bit. Well, the center's going that way, and I'm reversing that way. And that's a disaster waiting to happen. And or a belt, or anything you can reverse out like this, and he's reaching. So you just take a little timer step. And it's very brief. It's not a second, it's not even a half a second. It's very brief. And you don't have to really gain any ground there. You just got to pick your foot up and set it down again just to hang in there a little bit. Right? Just to hang in a little bit so your hands stay with his butt, and then you pivot and you come around and make the exchange. Now that's very, very, very important. If you don't do that, if you're pulling out, the ball's going to be on the ground. All right. Going back to the quarterback center exchange. My entire career coaching quarterbacks, whether they were in the NFL 15, 18 year pro centers and quarterbacks, or rookies, or freshman in high school, we spend 10 minutes every day in practice on the quarterback center exchange. Or shotgun and underneath the center. You can't get enough. You can't take those little details for granted. And we always stand somebody on a shade and make the center. You can't just snap the ball. He has to step and get his hand up right away. I'm amazed too, a little bit, that when we get centers and they're snapping the ball and they're so late with their hands. And that ball snapped, and that off hand's got to come right up immediately. You have to practice that. Because it does change your ass when he snaps the ball. And you have to practice all those things that come up from the center with the quarterback because it changes. Now, as I take the ball from underneath the center, I start moving. I know what the game is. Right? So I'm going to start moving as I call hut. I start to move. You don't get the ball, caught, and then go. It's too late. You run over. And then you leave your upper body full. Remember, you've got to get your upper body out of there and move. Dancing around with that first step. Okay? All right. And so, this, you see why it's pretty simple. We're just kind of scratching that whole thing. There's just so much information. All right, so. As I come back on a drop, let's talk about the three-step drop. Getting away from the center. First step is a big step and then two quicks. You go one big, two quicks. One big, two quicks. Your feet, when you drop to the quarterback, when you set, at no time should it ever, ever come together. So when I set, I never draw that foot together. There's a couple of, they should be in the Ten Commandments, a couple of things that are extremely important. Bent knees, flat shoulders. Bent knees, flat shoulders affects accuracy incredibly because it's all about balance. Balance is the number one thing for a quarterback to achieve consistent through his drops and resets. Tipped, the shoulders are tipped forward or back. That's a bad thing. So you're fighting in your drop to stay balanced and keep that head calm the whole time. So your footwork is very important as it applies to that as well. So I get back on my third step, and I want to throw, let's say I'm going to throw a slant over here. That young man standing over here, I'm going to throw a slant over here, right? So as I come back and I hit my third step, when you teach young men their first few drops, make them stop on a 3 to 5 step drop. Don't let them hitch forward. Because if they can't take 3 steps and stop and gather their hips a little bit, bend their knees, they're out of control, they're out of balance. There's a big lie perpetuated back in the 50s on up. Stand tall, hold the ball up here, and get up on your tiptoes. Unbelievable. And people have bought into that. That is so inefficient from every aspect biomechanically from the physical standpoint. It's ridiculous. I hate it. It just drives me nuts. Throwing the football should feel good. It should feel natural if you're a passer. Those things are concrete. Holding the ball high doesn't mean you're going to release the ball high. All it does is raise the center of gravity. And we'll get to that in a second. So I get back here and 3 steps, I'm going to throw it up there. When I set,
and I'm going to make my throw, I'm going to gather into that leg. Now, my weight is into that foot, not over it, and I'm on a flat foot there on an instep. I'm not on my tiptoes. Can't do anything on your tiptoes. You're off balance. So I hit that foot, my knees are bent, and I should be able to make that throw. When I line up the throw, where do I line up? I line up with my shoulder not at where I'm going to throw, but just to take past it. Even though I'm anticipating him catching the ball there, and even though he's running over there someplace, I line up to throw it there, I feel it, and I go, and I release the ball. But if I line my shoulders up, like for so many years guys used to teach, where I'm going to throw the ball, you've blocked yourself off. You can block yourself off. This foot should be perpendicular to where you want to put the ball. But if you will take your belly button, tell them to take the belly button, open it just a tick when they throw the football to their target. So now I'm not front end, and I'm not sideways. I just open a little bit, and that gets the hips out of the way. And that lets that whole lever system come through and finish. It's my fault. Throwing the ball is like a lot of things. It's really like a discus. It's like golf. There's a lot of things that transfer of energy. Line of force, inertia, all those good things. You don't want to interrupt any of that, because then it becomes much less efficient action. We good with that, okay? All right, throwing to the left. I had a chance to talk to a guy. I live in San Diego, and he was doing some stuff with the quarterbacks out there. He wanted me to go out and talk to him. He said, but what do you do throwing to the left? And then I looked at the whole thing. He said, this happened years ago, and it's a lie. They hit that foot and step over and throw at the same time. Well, think about it. I'm throwing the ball over here to the slant. I'm throwing over here and throwing on the move. You know how good you got to be to do that consistently? Okay. And their guys are good. That's not good. You're just going to have to do that way. You tell them at the end of your drop, take a little pigtail. A little pigtail step. If I'm going to throw that way, go ahead and take that foot and set it over here. And get lined up, opened up where I want to put this leg over there. If it's an out, I'm over here like this. And if they can't get that foot crowd that way at the end of their drop, then all you do is you tell them, take your belly button and start to rotate your belly button that way a little bit. And their feet will automatically do that. Their feet will automatically pop. That's kind of what a cheat do. Okay? All right. So as we come back on the drop, on a three-step drop, what am I doing with my arms? The first step, I've got the ball to bring the coverage, but by that second step, on a three-step drop, you need to make sure that you are looking right where you want to throw the football. Now again, I was at this bowl, and it just happens all the time with young guys coming out of college, is the first thing they do is they come back up, I'm going to throw it one, two, three, and they look and throw at the same time. I mean, you can do that, but you got to see what's going on over, don't you? And you got to get lined up and stop yourself a little bit. So we always make sure that the last two steps of any drop, you're finding that hole that you initially wanted to make, as we talked about earlier, wherever it is. The last two steps of any drop that you do, play action, five steps, seven steps, and then down, doesn't make any difference. The last two steps, you want to make sure your eyes and your shoulders are going to where you want to throw. Now, it's not just turn your eyes over there, because if you're going to throw it over there, you've left your body this way. So it's a neat little drill. You just have them pat their feet a little bit and have them move wherever they look. They've got to bring their shoulder and their belly button too. And when they work their feet like that, it forces them to keep their weight between their feet, which is balance. This is what it's all about, the balance, right? Okay. All right, so that third step, we said pause on it, make them pause, and keep doing it, and tell them to speed that pause up, or now it's very brief. Now what happens if the slant all of a sudden falls apart and they got to find somebody else? Well, that's a hitch, and this is a hitch. A hitch is just, that's all it is. One, two, like that. That's a hitch. Don't let them pop up and down, because the center of gravity goes up and down. It makes them late to throw the ball, then they tip like this to throw the ball. Make them do this. In fact, when they warm up, make them pitch a little bit and then throw, because that's how they'll play the game. That's how they'll play the game. Hitch, hitch, make that throw. So now if I'm buying time to find my checkup, I hitch, hitch, boom, and throw it over here. But I'm not gaining any ground with it, even though it's a quick throw. All right, which brings me to launch points. No matter what passage you throw, you have to coordinate it with the offensive line. They have to know where the quarterback is to protect it, right? So the launch point should be 4 yards, basically, 4.5 yards, 10 on 3 steps. And the shotgun, the timing, you keep the timing the same, because when you get the ball in the shotgun, and that's as soon as you get a hold of it, you're ready to throw. And it's really too quick. And then that sense of panic comes into these young quarterbacks. So to get them to hold their water a little bit and time it up, you don't need to get any depth, right? Because they're already at five. So and it's really hard to break them to have it on freeze. Just have them walk their feet twice. See, those hinges are also timing steps. They're buying steps, they're keeping you balanced, but it's also timing for those routes down the field, those 5-yard routes that we're talking about. We'll get it. All right. So I'm in the shotgun, I hit the ball, I snap my hips to where I want to throw it, I hitch once, hitch twice, I throw it, or I hitch again to get it to the outlet. Okay. And those timer steps, those hitches, are incredibly important. Do not let them hop up and down. That's the worst thing they could possibly do. Okay? 5-step drop. As I come away, the first 3 steps of that drop, I'm cruising and looking down the field, getting an idea. I know where I'm going to throw the ball. I'm going to be over here. As I get to through the 3rd step, I get my head and shoulders to where I want to throw the ball. So when I get that 5th step, I can let it go in the 5th step. If the route, and these routes are all about 10, 12 yards deep, maybe it's a 15-yard route that you want to do with the 5-step drop because you didn't have a big arm. Well, then tell him to take 5 steps and add a hitch to time it out. So in other words, if he's just get back to 5 steps, hitch it quick, and then let it go. But the route seems to take a little bit longer than what you'd like. Or if you've got a cannon, you're trying to back them off. What about timing and balance? Timing and balance. As I get away now, this is incredibly important. As you get away, this ball should be in the sternum just above the elbows. Should be the numbers. Aaron Rodgers, NBC played Cal, he had the ball almost on top of his head up here. As soon as you have to live for a while, the ball comes back where it belongs. It should be comfortable. Anytime you're carrying the ball and you flip the nose up like this, what does the elbow do? It goes out. So what does that do to the rest of you? So I'm dropping, I got the elbow up, and I'm dropping this one through my shoulders. I'm dropping back like this. It's not natural. Let them relax. Keep that down. And a lot of guys will keep the tip like this. But if he's got a small hand, or it's more comfortable, the natural thing to do is just let the ball rotate down and roll a little bit. Because when he throws the ball, he's just going to start back and go. Why swing it through all that stuff? It makes it more efficient. This is what we call tight and compact. Tight and compact. So you can affect the quickness of the delivery just on how he holds the ball when he gets back. Now, just how many guys coach track, sprinters, or any of that stuff? You know that the arms and the legs are connected, right? Timing-wise. Right? Same thing as a pass drop. So as I move my feet, the arms, you can't expect him to be good with his feet if you've got to hold the ball still. Let him relax that hand. And even if it's just 2 inches or so, that's fine. But let him move just a little bit to free up his hips and his feet. He'll be much more relaxed. All right, the launch point for a 5-step drop is 6.5 yards. And at 6.5 yards of that protection, you will never hitch up or move up and throw the ball if your first choice is gone. So, therefore, you have to hitch in place. If one's gone, I come back, I take a quick hitch and throw it there. I don't have it, I hitch again to get to number 2. So you're always hitching in place. And you can create your own thrills to make them do this. Because they're not going to want to do it naturally. The natural thing is, while they're waiting, they want to move forward. Well, they're going to move right up into the butts of the offensive line. And by the way, on all these, we tell the offensive interior 3, you want to do all your work on the line of scrimmage. It's amazing to me how guards and pass protection and so many different programs, the first thing they do is step back. The last thing we want to do. I've got a 3 technique. I'm going to step over, pull this foot, leave my weight on that leg, and I'm going to jump in with my hands up on a count, on a 2 count. So 1, 2, boom, I got my hands on. And I get in front of Reggie. That's how it goes. That's how it always goes. But there's so many guys that will have him get back here and catch him and get him up a yard to yard and a half. There's no reason. They have to engage him. Now the guy's got a head of steam. Throwing his hands and games and, you know, swim, all that kind of stuff. When I jump at the center, get that off the ball, snap, get that off pad, boom, right now, right down the middle. Stipe him as quickly as you can with that angle. So that they protect the pocket. Now, this is true for 5 and 7 for those guys up front and the 3-step. There's not much change. The time has changed. Short set to the regular sets. It does change. Launch point 6.5. should never be any closer than 6 yards. And on the five step from this way, as I come back, three step down the middle, my belly button comes around, and I look how I'm lined up before I want to throw. I'm opening up a little bit. Film it with the camera, have them go through this. And you know in your mind how it should look now. But watch it. If he's turning to the left, he's doing this and dropping that shoulder, that means he's trying to stop himself by leaning. And all these pass drops, you want to stop yourself with that plant step in the back. You got to hit that ground with some force. That's why when you start teaching them to drop, wherever I've been, we take 3 days of drop without ever from football, or even holding football. Just working on footwork and shoulders. Footwork and shoulders. If he wants to do it, it's okay. He's going to go this way, but keep the shoulders flat. Because by keeping the shoulders flat, it keeps the weight into that back foot. Not over it, but so I can press the back foot for the throw to make the launch or the throw. Bent knees. Bent knees. Okay? All right. In the gun, the five-step drop in the gun. Am I okay? Somebody here? Is that 45 minutes? I think maybe we'll finish that up. Would that be all right? We'll get that set up. We'll get in some play tonight. Any questions? Yeah.
One question I have is how far is it?
Okay, that's a very good question. It doesn't make any difference. Whatever he does. It's just like coaching with finishing a tennis swing. Who cares? That's an indication something's wrong a lot of times, but that step, when you step, Mark Bolger would walk himself off that top and get to open up the foot. Thanks for the haircut. That's not what we're talking about. Because, but his hip was open. That's how it is what it is. If they're balanced, it's going to finish you the way you want them anyway. They're balanced. You watch their steps as they come back. You'll see. On a five-step drop, the guys used to teach us at SC back in the 70s. You go one, two, and then the third step was a big hop step, and then they go one, two. They used to teach that. They used to teach that because they go one, two, three big steps, and they go boom, boom, two quick ones. Well, it's fine, but you're off balance now. So it's just all one, two, three, four, five. Now, here's the thing. It's not a carryover on a pass drop. Whether you're in the gun or in the center. As you come away, if you try and keep your toes to the sideline, you're locking them all up. Let them free up with their toes in a turn like this. They can still see what they got to see. And they'll free themselves up, and all of a sudden their stride length will become normal. And they're all the same. If you carry open, it's big, little. Once you watch your toes, there's a lot of things for you to watch when you start teaching them how to drop. And now they're starting to hit 6.5 with ease. If you carry open with the toes to the sideline, they'll have a hard time hitting 5 yards or 5 steps. Now those are all little tiny deals that are extremely important. The 3 and the 5 step, by the way, isn't just underneath the center. It all correlates to being in the shotgun as well. Otherwise, it'd be wasting a lot of guys' time. What we just went over underneath the center of the 3 to 5 is incredibly important for a shot. And then we'll talk about the 7-step drop and how that fits here later on the center. This thing kind of went by. That's why we said 45 minutes. But we'll come back and we'll finish up this stuff and we'll talk a little bit about the play design and how we approach it. And we'll go from there. Appreciate you this morning, man. Glad you came out.